associating so much with these generational curses when we have our own generational blessings?
Your sins are forgiven. That means that you are a candidate for the miraculous. It does not matter where you are. Once you hear my voice, the power of God will meet you.
And this is the record that God has given us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. He that has the Son has the life. We have the life of the Son of God. We are not ordinary.
You're about to listen to the visionary of Manifold Grace Ministries.
Engaging the spirit of faith. I've read the whole passage of scripture, but I will pick the ones to read. Can you put off the scripture from the screens and then so that everybody reads from the Bible? This first passage, as my manner is. Smith Wigglesworth said, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and 4, hold the key to the spirit-filled life. So I've been in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 4 for many years. Oh, how? I can quote the two chapters off at. Not because I sat down to memorize, but just because of constant reading and meditation. So we just pick from. I start from verse 3. If you are there, say amen. I'm reading from the Authorized King James Version. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel, which of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Verse 13, we having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus and shall present us with you. Verse 16, for which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more eternal exceeding weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are what? The eternal. Father, we thank you for the power of your word. Lord, as I dispense divine realities, thank you for you cause your words to burn and make imprints in our hearts, in the name of Jesus. Lord, even as you have promised, in due time, let the prophetic unction come strong. Thank you for our word. We lift us, change us, and give us impetus for action. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Engaging the spirit of faith. I'll be talking about four things. Revelation, the realization, the revolution, and reproduction. The revelation, the realization, the revolution, and reproduction. I tell you, this message will change your life. The revelation. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's the revelation. There is a message. There is the message. Okay? And this message that we preach is the gospel message. It is the revelation. The word used for revelation is apocalypsis. Apo is without. Calypsis means that there is a veil. The word that is used there is that the devil has blinded, veiled the minds of people. Revelation means that the veil has been removed. Okay? In the Old Testament, they saw veiled. You see, when there is a veil, you can see people moving behind, but you won't know who they are. Jesus Christ laid hands on a blind man. He said, what do you see? He said, I see men as trees walking. That talked about the first covenant. But he laid down, that talked about the second covenant. He saw all men the way God created them. There is a revelation. There is a gospel message. The gospel is the love, the light, and the life of God. It's the love of God, because it's through the love of God that we have received forgiveness of sins. That's the gospel. It's through the love of God that we can decree and declare that God is no longer angry with you. That it's through the love of God that we can boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. This is the gospel. The gospel is the revelation of God's light. The Bible says in him was life, and the life was the light of men. What light? The Bible says that he had delivered us from the kingdom of darkness. He has translated us, past tense, into the kingdom of the Son of his love. We are in the kingdom of light now. So that every time you see in scriptures, if you walk in the light as he is in the light, that light is talking about we are already there. The gospel is the life of God. He said, this is the record that God has given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has the life. He that has not the Son does not have the life. That life is definite article. Not normal life. The life. Superior in quality. Superabundant in quantity. This is the gospel. That now that we have made the great confession, we have been embraced by God's love forever. Now that we have made that great confession, we have been brought into the kingdom of light. That now that we have made that great confession, we have received the very life and ability of God. This is the key to the kingdom. This gospel is the key to all of God's treasures. God's love. We have experienced the love of God. People that experience this love, every other love fades away. A lady that has experienced this love, you cannot yarn the lady with all those sweet, sweet nothings. You understand? Just be direct and, just say the truth. Hallelujah. Because they receive superior love. Hallelujah. One that has received this love, the world has been estranged from that one. You know, many times you say that, you see, our Christians nowadays, they are worldly. The Bible says that, no, anyone that loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. That love of the Father does not mean, I love God. It means that God's love, the realization that God loves me, has not entered him. When Paul got a hold of this, he said, I count everything in my life as dung. He saw the love of the master. This is the key to the kingdom. You see, for long, I preached this, but for long, until recently, when I was studying, for long, I wondered why Jesus Christ said that the greatest parable was the parable of the sower. But we have to preach it. You know, there are revelations that we have not yet caught on to. Or you think we have caught everything? If you think we have caught everything, you are joking. No? Even after we have preached here 1,000 years, we won't see catch all the revelations. There are some things when Jesus says some things, I wonder, I sit down, I think, I say, why? Jesus, that woman was washing, using her hair to clean Jesus, washing, crying, and then alabaster box. Jesus Christ said, she did this for my burial. He said, everywhere the gospel is preached, what this woman has done shall be met. But we preach the gospel, we don't mention what she has done. That means that there is something in what Jesus, there is a revelation there. I'm still trying to crack it. I've not cracked it yet. If you crack it before me, please let me know. Hallelujah. But when Jesus Christ said here that the parable of the sower, he said, he told his disciples, if you don't understand this one, how will you understand all parables? It means that this parable is the key to all parables. Now, there is the, when we are teaching the word of God, there are different ways we teach. We teach doctrine. We teach revelation. We teach gnosis. First Corinthians, anyone that speaks, he might speak through revelation, through doctrine, through gnosis. Knowledge. Okay? So, many times you use the parable of the sower to talk about how faith works. But what Jesus was talking about, you will see it in Mark chapter 4. There's a prophecy from Isaiah chapter 6. There's in Mark chapter 4 that Jesus says that this is the parable that unlocks the prophecy. Because all the parables that Jesus was giving were parables about the kingdom. So when he says that this is the one that unlocks every other parable, he was saying that once you catch this and act on it, you have entered the kingdom. What is it in this parable? Mark chapter 4, when Jesus gave that parable, he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom. And then he said, but unto those that are outside, the Bible says, hearing they will not hear. That's what the parable is about. That they will hear, they will not hear. They will see, they will not perceive. Let they hear with their ears. They see with their eyes. They understand with their hearts. Now, it is that understanding that Jesus was talking about in the parable. He said that once they do that, I will forgive them. So, that's Mark's account. That means that what the parable was about unlocking forgiveness of sins. Jesus was actually saying that when this gospel is declared, there are some people that the enemy will come and take the gospel away. There are some other people that it will be as if it fell, you know, fell among thorns. There are some other people it will fall. They will rejoice and say, yes, 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 yes. This is the truth of the gospel, but they won't act on it. He said there are others that will understand and hold it and bring forth fruit. How will they understand our way? They will understand the gospel and believe the gospel and be forgiven their sins. Mark chapter 4. Put Mark chapter 4 up. Let's see that. Because that is the key he's talking about. Mark chapter 4. This is in the middle of the parable of the sower. Okay? And he said unto them, unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without. All things are written in parables. And he said unto them, okay, I've done the parables. Next. That seeing, you see, that's Isaiah's prophecy. When Paul in Acts, when he preached to the people and they rejected the gospel, it was this same prophecy Paul said. It's this same prophecy. They said that these people have refused forgiveness of sins. He said, this is what Isaiah said about you. Now, Jesus is saying that this is the key to unlocking it. That seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins should be forgiven. Now, what he's saying, this is what this parable is about. Next verse. And he said unto them, know ye not this parable? How then will ye know all parables? That means that Jesus was saying that if you understand this parable of the sower, it is key to unlocking the kingdom. And the parable of the sower is that some people hear the word of God and say, you will see it in the Acts of the Apostles. People will hear, they will reject it. The devil has stolen the seed. The other people that we hear, they be excited and say, come, we will hear you again about this matter next week. The other people that we hear, they will say, just like what John said, they valued the glory, the praises of men, more than the praises of God. Those are the ones in the thorns. Thorns are rising up. It has suffocated the word of God. He said then, but there is a group of people that go past this prophecy because they see with their eyes, they hear, they understand, they are converted, their sins are forgiven. When this happens to a man, you have unlocked all the parables. You have entered the kingdom. Hallelujah. That's the gospel. Our sins are forgiven. God has become our Father. That's the gospel. The gospel is that we have received eternal life. That's the gospel. And that's why you see that in scriptures, this forgiveness of sins does not come by works. Look at the life of Jesus. The people that Jesus forgave their sins, it was in response to their faith. It was in response to their faith. The brother man that was paralyzed, Jesus saw their faith. And then he said, son, your sins are forgiven you. Another time, this woman came and washed his feet and everything. At the end, Jesus Christ said, go in peace. Your faith has saved you. Because forgiveness of sin is an act based on our faith in the gospel, not by our workings. And that's why the gospel produces the highest number of people that are healed of HIV. Because there are many sicknesses that thrive in condemnation. HIV is one of them. It thrives in condemnation. And the flesh likes hearing those kind of things. If you had not gone to eat the yam, You will not, or if you have not got to eat the oil, you won't have stains on your mouth. You know, all those kind of things. You know, you can't chop and clean mouth with God. These are the kind of things people say, yeah, it's true. It's true. I have failed God. No, that is why HIV tries. But when you hear that he has made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. You step out, healing comes. Praise God forevermore. Say it is the revelation. The revelation is that I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. The revelation is that my sins are eternally forgiven. Not by the works of righteousness which I've done, but by his own mercy saved me. By the washing of regeneration and renewing done by the Holy Ghost. That's the gospel. The gospel is that after Jesus Christ had done this, he sat down waiting until all his enemies be made his footstool. For by one sacrifice, he has perfected forever those that are sanctified. That's the gospel. Is able also to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. That's the gospel. It's the revelation. It's the revelation. Somebody met me at the airport. I said, sir, okay, you met me. I said, you came to our church last year to minister, everything. So it was about boarding his flight yesterday. So he came and said, sir, I want to ask you, sir, this power, the glory, the testimonies in your life, How do I move up higher? He said, because I've been praying. I said, prayer is there, but before prayer is apocalypsis. Is what? It is we all with open face first before prayer. Because this revelation is the amplifier of prayer power. That's why he says that the earnest, heartfelt prayer of a condemned man. Is that what it says? Okay, if you paraphrase it, of the condemned man, he blocks the two, makes trickles of power available. That's why there are people that are drinking coke. Eh? Rev is drinking coke like this. Somebody comes and says, sir, demons, them demons. I see them in my dream. Yesterday night, they were flogging me. They were pursuing me. Rev is saying, you are in church now. Go. And he's gone. There are other people that are climbing mountain for 40 days to do the same thing. Praying 40 days. And why is it that 40 days prayer and somebody else is drinking coke? It's revelation. It's revelation. The earnest, heartfelt prayer of the righteous man. Papa Higgins said that, he put it in his book, if only I could be righteous, I will be a whiz at praying. If only I could be righteous. Then one day found out that he has made him to be sin for us. Who knew no sin? He instantly became a whiz at prayer. I remember the first day, the first E.W. Kenyon's book I read in secondary school was Hidden Man of the Heart. When I read that book, I said, Kai, God, please let what this man is saying be true. I was like, God, let what this man be, what he said, let it be true. Let it be true. I was so excited. I went around taking prayer points. Right? Please, do you have prayer points? List them. Bring it. I have just found out who I am. Hallelujah. It's the revelation. God who commanded delight to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And that's why this revelation is a look into the face of Jesus Christ. Every time we see the truths of the gospel, we are looking into his face. You know, many times when we tell people, just look up to Christ, they don't understand. They say, I'm looking up to him, but what they are looking at is Christ of Passions of the Christ. Christ of Jesus of Nazareth. That's why I say, I'm looking up to him. He's very white, what was named, they wrapped around here. I'm looking up to him. No. Looking at the world is looking at Christ. Looking at what he has done is looking at the Christos. So when you say, who himself in his own body bear my sins on the tree, that I being dead to sin may live unto righteousness, by whose stripes I was healed, you are looking at his face. We that we are dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of our flesh, he has raised up together with him, having forgiven us all trespasses. You are looking at his face. Say amen. But then the second one, it says, this is the part. It says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. This is the realization. This comes by internalizing. This realization is where the power starts with people. That's why there is a difference between reading God's word and studying God's word and meditating on God's word and confessing God's word. They are not the same. Paul said to Timothy, till I come, give attendance to reading. That means that we should be reading God's word, amen? And sometimes you should just be reading large portions of God's word. Lester Sumra went to visit Sweet Wiggles World for the first time. He had been hearing about the mighty British evangelist. He went to visit Sweet Wiggles World. Sweet Wiggles World met him at the door. It was during World War, around that World War, late 30s or so. He said, what's that in your hand? He said, it's newspaper. I said, drop that thing outside. They are full of lies. It does not enter my house. Mussolini and Hitler will be in hell very soon anyway. Come inside. So he entered inside. He said he sat down. Smith carried Bible 1 hour and started reading. Not explaining, not teaching. He just read, started reading. Do we again begin to commend ourselves, or need we letters of commendation from you? Ye our epistles, written in our hearts, known and read. 1 hour, he was just reading like that. After reading for 1 hour, he closed the Bible. Let's pray. Markata every day, they prayed for 1 hour. After praying for 1 hour, he opened the Bible, continued reading for another 1 hour. And then he closed the Bible and prayed again 1 hour, 4 hours. Lester Sumra said, as he was there, he said, come, does this man think I'm illiterate? I don't know how to read and write. Me, I can read this Bible now. Why is he just reading the Bible? He said, this is the last time I will come here. He said, sir, I'm going. He said, okay, God bless you. As he was going, he said, his heart was drawing back to where it was coming from. It's the anointing. So there is reading where we just read. There is study, because study will help meditation. You cannot meditate if you don't understand God's word. Because meditation is direct application. It is meditation that absorbs the nutrients of the world into our being, the core of our personalities. That means that people can meditate on God's word such that their body language will change. You might be somebody that says, hey, goodness, sir. Yes, sir. Meditation on God's word, you will come out. All those genuflections will change. The way you walk will change. Because the word of God has mixed with your DNA. But it starts with study. Because it's from study you will know, you will break it in pieces. Look, reading the word of God is like giving you yam, you know, plenty like this. Okay? In study, you will break it into pieces. In meditation, you are now eating it and absorbing it. Or else, if you carry it like this, how will you eat it? Internalizing means that you bring the word and make it your own. That's why it has to be broken. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. It does not make sense to many people. That's why Pastor Joe was teaching yesterday. What does it mean to be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus? How does it affect my daily life? How does it affect my daily life? It means that nothing dies in my hands. Now you are meditating. You have brought it home to your life. Nothing dies in my hands. It means that even if things were dead, once I touch them, they become alive. That's meditation. It means that God has marked me for mighty supply. It means that I am reigning in life as a king. So reigning in life as a king, I start putting it in. That means in my company itself, all those people that are ahead of me, they should give way. I'm supposed to be the one controlling that company. That you are meditating. This is how to internalize. The reason why Christians shy away from things is because they have not internalized the gospel. I'm a businessman. I'm looking for a contract. What have you done? But they have said that people should submit, you know. They are doing tenders, you know. People should submit. Don't mind those people. Don't mind them. Yeah, don't mind them. All these people, all these things they are putting inside newspaper. They are just wasting time. They already know the people they want to give the contract to. They are just doing that one to fulfill your righteousness. And you say you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And then you come back and say that, look, in the crowd, God picks me out because I'm righteous. Then what's this talking about? They say they are looking for people that will go on exchange program in a school in Europe. They say three people that are supposed to go. Three. And they say we should give our names. Me, I don't give my name for that kind of rubbish. Because by the time they put Vice Chancellor's daughter, by the time they put Bossa's son, and by the time they put Governor of Kogi State, by the time they put his son, everybody is complete. So they are just deceiving us. They are deceiving you. They are deceiving you. That means that you have not internalized the truth. Aye, Kai, basic, I had a. Hallelujah. You have to see yourself as the actor in the book. We have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellence of the power might be of God and not of us. See yourself in the book. Internalize it. See all those promises fulfilled in your life and in your lifetime. This is what will give impetus to your legs. See yourself as the possessor of the mighty supply. Because this is very necessary. What we call confession is the product of this process. It's the product of this process. You have to see your now. There are some people that every time you want to say something, they always make our day look smaller than other days. Somebody told me one day, that was years ago as a captain, there was somebody that had a conversion attack, you know, that was there. He came and looked at and said, "This guy, player, you want my senior player like this." He said, "You can see us. We are powerless. If Jesus was here, Jesus would have healed that man. And we are just standing here." I said, "Oga, talk for yourself." I said, "Oga, talk for yourself. Don't admit your. I am not powerless." He said, but what are you?" I said, that man by the beautiful gate, was Jesus not passing there every day? Was Jesus not passing there every day? In 3.5 years of ministry, he was passing the man every day until he died and rose up again. It was Peter and John that came to raise him up. Because people like making us feel that our day is less than before. People that pray, "Give us the powers of Elijah. Elijah, Elijah. The days of fire, these days are greater than the days of Elijah." They are greater. They are greater. I'm going somewhere because this thing, you must see yourself as part of the big picture. If you don't see yourself, you won't see manifestation. You have to internalize the truths of the gospel until you see yourself as a walking, talking manifestation of the gospel. People talk about meetings. They say, "You look at." They say that meeting was awesome. You see the power of God came upon blessed is that meeting. We are still falling short of Bible times. In the Bible times, the Bible says the place where they were gathered was shaking. Did your building shake under the anointing? Because people were falling, go and read the Bible well. If you look at the Bible, the Greek syntax is not talking about the building shaking under the anointing. When the Bible says the place where they're, it's just like saying that, you know, when people started hearing gunshots, everybody in fact, the place just scattered. The place scattered does not mean that the building fell down. The same word that is used, salio, that is used for the place where they were saying was shaking, is talking about the contents of the, is the same word that is used when it says pressed down, shaking together. Is it the container we are talking about or the contents of the container? What happened there last night when the power of God hit this place? That was the place where they were assembled was shaking. That means that what they saw once, in the Acts of the Apostles, that they had to register it, we are seeing it regularly now. See what? I have put myself in the picture of scriptures. Others are separating themselves. I have seen myself in the Bible. I've seen that Christ is working out his life and his days in me here now. The person that sees this becomes the extraordinary man of God, extraordinary woman of God. They are the ones that do great things. The disciples were shy people, shy, always running away until they saw themselves in scriptures. All the while Jesus was there, they didn't see themselves in scriptures. It was when they were writing in retrospect that they saw, okay, the first time they saw themselves in scriptures was when they were trying to choose a replacement for Judas. He said, for it's written, lest his place be desolate and his bishopric, let another take. That means that they had seen that they were part of the bishopric that the Bible was talking about. All this while, they didn't see themselves as part of the Bible. They were doing career planning. It was then they saw themselves as part of the Bible, as part of the big picture. That what the Bible is saying here, it is me the Bible is talking about. Say the Bible is talking about me. Say the Bible is talking about me. They asked John the Baptist, who are you? He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. He saw himself in scriptures. Many times, when you get to revelation stage, people won't disturb you. Once you get to realization state, all hell will break loose. Jesus found a place where it was written, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach. The Bible says that we are looking at him and wondering the gracious words that were proceeding from his mouth. Wow. And this man, he didn't go to school, and look at how he's just releasing the words with fluency. People were clapping. Good presentation. He closed the book. They said, bros, go and sit down now. Then he entered realization. Because this is what realization is. This day, is this scripture fulfilled in your head? That means realization means that you stand before people and say, I am the fulfillment of the scriptures you have been reading. You know, the Bible says that we should always pray that God will create in us a new heart and renew our right spirit within. I am the fulfillment of that scripture. I'm the fulfillment of that scripture. As soon as he said, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your head, Kasala burst. As he said, who is it to say so? And that's how it is when you take your place, realizing what the word has said concerning you. Paul and Barnabas, Acts 13, they preached unto the Jews. As they were preaching, they were rejecting. That's what we are talking about, parable of the sower. The seed fell by the wayside. They rejected it. And then they waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the gospel be preached first unto you. But since you reject it and consider yourself unworthy of eternal life, we turn to the Jews. For so as the Lord commanded us, when they said that they quoted Isaiah, that means that they saw themselves in the picture. They quoted Isaiah. Isaiah did not put the name of Paul there. He didn't put Barnabas there. But by meditating, they saw that this thing is talking about us. That's where the gospel gains traction in your life. If people don't break into this on their own, God will cause events to happen to make you break into it. I know one man. He has gone home to be with the Lord now. Mighty man of God in Ibadan. Many miracles. But before then, he was always climbing the mountain to go and pray. He will climb. And you know those people that will climb Posi? Agbara. Ay! 40 days. Agbara 1930. You know what? The power of 1930. Apostle Babalola. Agbara 1930. They will be there. That he said he was so broke, every after 40 days prayer and fasting, he will break with garri and coconut water. He was there until one day he was coming down from the mountain. He was so weak after 30 days prayer and fasting. He was so weak. He tripped and started rolling down the mountain. At the base of the mountain, there were people that were blind, crippled, that used to beg at the base of the mountain. As he came rolling down and hit them, their eyes opened. The lame jumped up and said, hey, who was that? Who is that? I'm walking. Who is this man? He looked, he said, you mean it's as I jammed you people like this that miracle happened? He said, so this thing has been here. That was realization. That was realization. That was realization. When it seems as if God is putting you in tight places, it's because of realization. Paul said that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. After that, he says that we are pressed in on every side. He talks about pressure coming. Pressure, why? That the life of Jesus inside might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. That's the reason for the pressure. When there are disappointments, God wants you to rise up. It is so that you can realize what is inside you. All the things rising up to you, you know, rising up, it's so that you can know that you are a possessor of the mighty supply. So that all those things, you use them to move to your next level. What has been tripping others, you will use it to move to your next level. Renard Bonnke, as a young evangelist, he said that he heard that a mighty healing evangelist was coming around, so he invited the healing evangelist and put posters. As the healing evangelist was giving him bad body language, so he made posters and everything. And when the man came, he told the man, "Sir, we are putting on the posters that you are going to preach, you are going to pray for the sick." The man said, "Okay, I'm not sure if I can do that today." So the morning the man preached, the man was about to go. He said, sir, you have not prayed for the sick. He said, He said, okay. As the man was going, he came and announced and said, this evening, the man of God will be back. He will pray for the sick. So just come back this evening. He went with the man of God went to the hotel room. When he went to pick the man of God in the evening, the man of God has packed his baggages. I said, "Sir, we still have meeting today, tomorrow." The man said, "I'm going." "Ah," he said, "sir, but you promised, even God offended. Sir, you promised us. You promised us that you were going to be here for the meeting. I have told the people you will pray for the sick." At this time, Renard Bonnke was crusade administrator, organizer. "You have said that you will pray for the sick." He said, "I have told you I cannot do again," and left. Renard Bonnke said he entered into his car and was going for the meeting because the people were already gathered. There were tears in his eyes as he was going. He came and stood on top of the podium and looked at the people that were sick, that were broken. He said, "I have to be truthful with you. The man of God, the great man of God, he has left town." He said, "But Jesus, when he preached the gospel, he now told the people, he said, now God is going to do miracles. If you are blind in your eyes, get ready. When I finish praying, your eyes will open." He said he finished praying and then he shouted over the congregation, "Oh, blind eyes, see!" He said there was silence, and then from one corner he heard, "I can see." Since that time of that "I can see," many people have been seeing. Last count, I'm a partner, they sent me a message. Last count, in 41 years of ministry, they have had 74 million conventions. 74 million. If not that God pushed him into that situation, Renard Bonnke by now might still be a crusade organizer. When he's organizing crusade, he will call Benihin, he will call people, he will be the crusade organizer. But it was through what happened, the pressure, that God caused that life to come out. It was then he realized that he had this treasure in nothing vessels. Hallelujah. After the realization comes the revolution. The revolution comes by speaking. We all having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, "I believe, therefore have I spoken." We also believe and therefore speak. This revolution comes because we have taken a firm stand of faith. Because this revolution is not just speaking alone. Because he said, "I believe, therefore have I spoken." Knowing this, there is a knowing for the speaking. This is the declaration that brings manifestation. There's a knowing for the speaking. Once the man has seen himself, words will come out with power. When I got to Ijebode, before I got there, they said, "Ah, sir, that Ijebode full of witches. Witches. You know this man's father, and they are the ones that killed him. If you see the way they rubbished his life, where they, before, I told the person, before, I said, ah, it's as if you don't know me, oh. It's as if you don't know me, oh. I said, those people are afraid of me. If they hear I'm coming, they'll be shaking now. They'll be pissing in their pants. I got to Ijebode. I'd just been there for some days. The next thing, there was a case, witchcraft case, waiting. They said, sir, you see, this is how we do it. I said, no, not when I'm around, though. I laughed. The next conference I went for with the soldiers, I looked, I said, it's as if you people don't know me. Go and find out about me. In this place, don't allow me to stand up. I said, don't allow me to stand up. If I stand up, it will be bloody. That's all I said. Up to tomorrow, there is no case of witchcraft again. It is declaration that comes by realization. That's why when people are talking about the state, you know, TSA, you see the way TSA has hammered us. You know, all those you stories, and then you join up and say, nah, so, because we don't know where the country is going to. Aye! It's because you have not seen it inside you. You have classed yourself with the masses. When I read newspaper and I see statistics, and I see, do you realize that there are 1% of the world is controlling 80% of the world's wealth? I say, ah, so we are just 1%. So we are just 1%. I didn't know that we are very few like this. We are just 1%. I don't say, you can see the way people are suffering, the masses. You see, I have joined the other side. I can't put myself in those statistics. 70% are living below poverty level. I can't be part of that 70%. 95% are living middle class life. I'm not part of that 95%. 4% are living just enough. I'm not part of that 4%. 1% is controlling the wealth. 90%, that is where I am. And because I see them like that, we act that way. Okay? We give out to the poor. We send, look. This is the declaration from realization. When you see things inside newspaper, when you see things that are needed in church, you see yourself as the person they are talking to. Want to do a project? It will cost us 20 million naira. All those people, we park jeep outside. Now them, then they talk to now. All those ones that are parking jeep outside, how much do I have to give? 20 million. If I give 100 naira, what is that to 20 million? You see, you have not realized, you have not internalized it. Once you say, I am the one that pastor is talking about, the resources will come to your hand. And once you are stretched that way, you cannot go back to your original dimensions. So when people are talking, you see, life is that. No. It says when men are cast down, you will say. It does not say you will be lifted up. It says you will say it. You will say it. There is lifting up. You will say it. It must be said. My wife was working on a comatose park. The park has been there for years, ages. Your scanty park. Anybody that wanted to work on it, they have been frustrated. My wife came and said, okay, we start working on it. The people came and said, madam, you are not the first person here. People have been here, they don't take the day before you. Nothing works because here they will just frustrate you, they will do everything. My wife said, you have met another woman. Because me, nothing dies in my hands. If I put my hand inside death, death will lose its power. Pastor Joe said it yesterday. They might say that this car is problematic. Take, I dash you. As soon as it becomes yours, the spirit, the evil spirit of problems, will jump from there and go to the nearest car. And go and possess that car. And leave this one alone. Because life is working in you. It's here. Rapaka sekebelifi sutaya brando koshta halike. Zintale kepekiso. Zevrige go shahata ya balabuko sokeliapa. Ada stand up. Predi sekebe kazuka. Ratika lebato repe sekebe akasakala. I see your legs standing in two rivers. See your legs standing in two rivers. And I see you facing the north. And I see your eyes burning like fire. Those two rivers are the rivers that enter the country. And I see you facing the north with your eyes burning like fire. The Lord says he has made you a controlling power over this region. He has made you a controlling power over that region. Take it for the gospel. Stand on your chair. Godwin, Victor, stand on your chair. Reverend Doctor, stay around them. The Lord says, be patient. The times of lifting are just ahead of you. They are just ahead of you. Be patient. They are just ahead of you. Get your house ready. For enlargement is just ahead of you. Those are prophetic actions. Nike leka taya bradosto noti rekebredista has the kepakatayaba raki le brados. Just lift up your hands there. Resike lemba taya bradosu hokotoye engalize kataya bratike zoke leba tayaba. I see you striking the city, and I see the structures shaking. I see your voice being heard. The Lord says, now your voice shall awaken the dead. Shall awaken the dead. Help him. Shall awaken the dead. Those that are dead, lost hope. Those that God has set up, they are like sleeper cells. Your voice shall awaken. To the one that I adore. You're the one. Reverend Otto, but are the things that are not seen? For the things that are seen are temporal. The things that are not seen are eternal. You have seen the revelation. You have internalized it. You have realized the revolution has taken place with your speaking boldly. Boldly. The Bible says, in nothing terrified by your adversary. To them is a token of perdition. They know their time is up. Now, how we reproduce results always is through what we call instrument flying. Many of those pilots inside the planes, when they turn upside down, they don't know they're upside down. Because to them, they are going straight. They rely on those instruments to know azimuth, to know bearing, to know every altitude, everything. They rely on the instruments. That means in our lives, the way we reproduce results is by looking at what God has said and not what is happening around us. Now, the first one, the realization, the revelation, is the gospel. The realization comes through meditation. The revolution comes through declaration. This one, the reproduction, comes through the spirit of seeing and knowing. David went to battles many times. His style for battle was never the same. One key to failure, I know, is formula. When you try to attack everything the same way, they say if the only instrument you have is a hammer, all problems will look like nails. Seeing and knowing. That means that you are seeing what people are not seeing. We pray in other tongues until we see what others don't see. That's how the thing that is general to our other people becomes particular and held by us. Reverend Moses was saying it. The Lord has said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Yet they wanted to obey the commandments of the Lord. The Lord forbade them from entering Asia. They wanted to obey the commandments of the Lord. The Lord stopped them from entering Bithynia. And then in the night, a vision of the night, a man from Macedonia said, come over to Macedonia and help us. That is what reproduces the results. Seeing and knowing. That means that we are seeing outside of this realm. We are seeing the things that other people are not seeing. The Bible says, against hope, Abraham believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations. That means that others were seeing his dead body. He was seeing a father of many nations. Others were seeing that Sarah had passed menopause. He was seeing the woman, the mother of many nations. When you see this way, things will shake you. People that say faith is a risk is because they are formula people. The people that have seen this way, they don't see it as risk. Seeing and knowing. That means that if they had come to meet Abraham and say, congratulations, your wife is ovulating, it would have made any difference to him. Oh, wow. Very bad news, sir. Very bad news. Your wife's womb destroyed. He flushed out safe. There's no way. It wouldn't have made any difference. The Bible says of Moses, he endured as seeing the invisible. This is the secret of reproduction. Of getting results over and over again. David would say, Lord, how do we go out? He says, go out, pursue, overtake. The next time, how do we go out? Go out. When you hear the sound of the goings on the mulberry trees, they strike. The next time, how do we go out? He's seeing and knowing. That's how we produce results. In prayer, your eyes are open. You pray to the point of seeing. So we say, I don't see anything. Me, I see plenty, plenty, plenty. See plenty, plenty, plenty. I've seen these meetings before I came here. I see myself flowing. I've seen myself in different countries, different parts of the country. I've seen the future. I've seen my children in the future. How? In prayer. Then you see visions being generated. Woman said, my wife said, prayer point. I want to have a baby. The second baby, we have this baby 6 years or 7 years. No, we want to have the second baby. Says, no problem. I have seen it already. It's coming. Say, I see. One eye's opening can solve a lot of problems. Can solve a lot of problems. You won't need to struggle again. You've declared, pray, you will see the strategy. You will see the way to go. You will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. Walk down in it. I'm giving the testimony of why we're in Abuja here. You know, I wanted to move house, and the house people were doing us like this. You know, like this. And finally, I was in Sierra Leone. I told my wife, that house, God has given it to us. I declared, God has given it to us. That's declaration. But it was not yet our own. The landlord was evasive. Finally, after spending time praying and fasting, one day, the next day, they said the landlord was available. So my wife went to see the landlord. The problems, I had seen it in prayer. That means you start seeing barriers, obstacles in prayer. Obstacles in prayer, and you'll be clearing them in prayer. So that when you come to the place and say, sir, this is the problem we have, this is the problem. I say, no. The skeleton of that problem has been cracked. All you are seeing is just form. It's virtual reality. The real thing, we have destroyed it. She met the man. The man said, okay, madam, Pastor B is there. Pastor B was, Pastor B, he was there. You know. He said, okay, madam, I need 2 years. My wife said, but the agent said it's only 1 year. I said, it's very unfortunate, though. It's 2 years. My wife stood behind. This is instrument flying. That means, instrument flying means that you are not looking outside, because outside might deceive you. You are looking at your instrument as you are flying.
Keep your eyes there. I trust that it shall be as it was told me of the Lord. She was there. She said, Madam, sorry, we can't do anything for you. Rapasikata labradoshtaha. Dizegalianto. Reshekapayaba. A name dropped in her spirit. That is how we reproduce. A name dropped in her spirit. She asked me, I said, I don't know, do you know so and so person? I called the name of the officer. Say, well, I know an officer that I don't know whether it's the same one. I know an officer that's called. In fact, let me call him. Picked up his phone and called the officer. I said, hey, there's one and Mrs. Akiojo is here. That you say, he talked to her. I said, yes, let me talk to you. So, gave my wife the phone. My wife said, Oga, long time ago. We have not even heard from you. I said, what's the problem? He said, we want this man's house and the man is giving us problem. I said, don't worry. Even if you want that house without paying, he will give you. Give him back the phone. He gave the man the phone. The man was just saying, okay, tall. Tomadala, tall. Okay. All right. Okay. And cut the phone. Dropped it, removed his cap. He said, this man has spoken with, is like a brother to me. I can't refuse anything he says. Madam, the house is yours. My wife brought out the check. I said, so I will just write the check. Madam, forget about check now. Don't pack into the house. Just pack inside. Pack inside. His instrument flying. If you come up this way, everything you see on earth will be small when you look at them. Small. The things that are troubling your heart, worrying your heart, will not look like a trouble or a bother any longer. They won't. Because you are looking from above. Pray to the point of seeing. Pray to that point of seeing. Pray to that point where impressions are in your heart. Pray to that point where there are actionable impressions on your heart. Pray to that point where you are moved to go and open that bank account. You are moved to register that company. Pray to that point. The people doing it don't have towards. They don't have towards. Pray to that point where you see and you start taking action. It's enduring as seeing the invisible. This is the place where there are perpetual miracles, where results are reproduced without stress.
You have been listening to the Visionary of Manifold Grace Ministries, a God-breathed ministry with a mandate to lift believers into new levels of victory via the teaching of the word of faith and the release of the supernatural. To partner with us or to download more messages, visit www.manifoldgraceministries.org. You can follow us on social media at Manifold Grace Ministries. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at Manifold Grace Ministries. God loves you.